Welcome to the Medical Device Made Easy podcast. Here is Munir Al-Azouzi from easymedicaldevice.com, and today we'll perform the June update. This is normally a term used in the financial departments, but here we'll review all what happened during the month of June and see if we can really provide you some great news on that. And we'll start on the agenda on the coronavirus situation. So we'll show you some details or new releases that were done by the EU Commission. We'll talk again about the MDR and IVDR implementation rolling plan. So this is something where there is always some surprises, but we'll talk about that. We'll go through the Green Belt certification program that Easy Medical Device was issuing and provide some of the result of it. We'll again talk about the notified body situation and then the guidances and standards that were released. And at the end, we'll check what happened within Easy Medical Device within this month. Okay, so let's start with the coronavirus. So it's a recurring term because we are still having this situation in the world where there is a lot of people that are dying, that are infected by the coronavirus. There is a rise actually in the US, which is something that is alarming. So related to that, in Europe, what happened is the fact that the EU Commission issued a survey just to check the notified body situation related to the coronavirus product. And what you can see within this report is that there is a lot of numbers. There is a lot of things that can be really interesting. If you are a manufacturer that wants to release some COVID-19 medical supplies, then this survey can help you to see some timeline for your application, when you may expect to have some results or some approvals for your products. And what we can see, I will just go through some numbers of it. So we can see, for example, for an average time to initiate a processing of the application, it depends if it's a new application or if it's just a change of your current process. For example, 36% of notified bodies will process the new application within less than 15 days, and 16% of notified bodies will process new application within more than 1 month. So it's also some differences. But one number that is also important is that 16% of notified bodies under MDD will not at all take any new application. So it's also something that is interesting to read. And then there is some numbers in terms of average time to have the product approved, which is, for example, 1 to 3 months. If it's a new product within your current certificate, if you have already a certificate and you want to add a new product to it, it is 3 to 6 months if it's a new product, but it's not covered by your certificate. You have also, it depends on classification, if it's class 1 sterile or with measuring function, it will be 1 to 3 months. If it's class 2A, it will be 1 to 6 months. If it's class 2B, it depends on the conformity assessment, but it can be from 3 to 6 months or 6 to 12 months, for example, for Annex 3 or Annex 4 under MDD, because there is less notified bodies that can go through this route. What we have also regarding UMDR, we have a limited number of notified bodies already within the Nando database, so it's something that is already a problem for some manufacturers. And within this limited number, there is already 10% that say that they will not take care of any new application for COVID-19 products. For IVDD, there is 14% of notified bodies that will perform the review and assessment within less than 1 month, and 14% that do that within more than 3 months. So it's also the difference. And within IVDR, there is only one notified body that accepted to take new applications for COVID-19 products. The two others said no. Okay, so this is really some important information, as I've said, for manufacturers that want to perform some kind of assessment when they can receive an application. But when you see those numbers, you say that, yeah, 3 months, 1 month already to maybe have your application processed, 3 to 6 months to maybe have your products already on your certificate. So it's more like 4 or 5 months. But at the end, the coronavirus is also kind of a crisis. It's an emergency. So it's also something that where products should arrive quickly on the market. So it's something that maybe could be frustrating for some manufacturers. But I'm sure it's also frustrating from some notified bodies because they have also to deal with other issues here. If you are still asking yourself what are COVID-19 medical supplies, the European Commission created a list for that because I think it can be confusing. Maybe some of you says that, yeah, it's only face mask, respirator, or COVID-19 tests, but there is much more than that because when you are a patient in the hospital, you don't need only that to get survived. So it's also something where you need also to look at it. So the list contains more than 50 articles, so you can go there. There is some catheter, some syringe, some anesthetic products, some gas products also. So there is a lot of things there. I mean, when you look at the list, there is a lot of things that maybe you can supply for the hospitals. And as I've said, it as the coronavirus is really an emergency, this can be also something that can help some countries or help some hospitals to maintain some patients in the survival mode. So I will put this list on the show notes. Go and check the show notes and you will see that. There is also a list that the European Commission issued, which is the COVID-19 IVDD test. So IVD test. This is the list of all the tests that were, if I can say, on the database for the European Union. So you can go and check there if there is some products that are interesting for you, or if maybe you want to check if one product was really approved or really on the database of the European Commission. So the link will be also on the show notes. Now let's go to the MDR, IVDR implementation measure for the rolling plan. So you know maybe this document, this is the kind of list of activities that the EU Commission is doing. This is the plan, this is the activities that they are going through, and also with some kind of estimation of timeline. And there is a lot of things inside that are sometimes changing, that are sometimes not changing at all, or that are sometimes a bit confusing because we don't know exactly what is the situation. But yeah, I picked some of them here. So we have, for example, the common specification for the reprocessing of single-use medical devices, which is undergoing a formal adoption. So it means that maybe we will see that soon, but there is no date specifically. It just said that it's undergoing formal adoption. Then we have the common specification for non-medical purpose devices. And this one is in planning. So I don't know what is the timeline for that, but this is also something that we need to have. So the manufacturers of non-medical device purpose products will need so they can place their products on the market. If it's not published before date of application, they will have then 6 months to implement it as soon as it's published. So it's something that we had made on a LinkedIn Live, if you want to go with Eric Volbrecht, with Stefan Bollaninger. So go and check that. We answered a lot of questions related to those type of products. Then we have again the information about EudaMed that will be planned for 2022. It says here that there will be 6 modules that will be released, and as soon as one module is available, they will release it. So we don't know exactly what it means. We don't know if it can be possible to be released before or not. We know already that the ACTOR module will be released by 2021. But yeah, out of that, we don't have more news about that. The last one is about standardization. I don't know if you followed the information, but you remember last time we discussed about the fact that CN and Senelec had to receive the mandate from the European Commission to work on the harmonized standard for EU MDR and EU IVDR. So in June 17, there should have been an answer to accept formally this mission. And in June 16, they received already an answer saying, no, it's not possible. We will not do that. So we are trying to understand what's the situation. And Eric Volbrecht created a blog, so you can go to his blog post on his website. So it was really interesting to read what he's marking. And you can understand the situation. You can understand why they have done this or why there was this situation. So to understand how this is working exactly in the behind the scenes. The thing is, he used, if I can say, the way to explain it, he used the way of a telenovela. So to explain how dramatic it is, how the situation can be seen like a telenovela movie. So if you don't know those kind of series, it's a Latin American series where there is a lot of drama inside. There is a lot of kind of soap opera, etc., etc. So it's something that is interesting. And here at Easy Medical Device, we decided to look at the telenovela and create the EU Commission telenovela. So if you want to have a view of it, so here it is.
A dramatic news.
I refuse your mandate.
Some political drama.
I'm doing fine. She's still not over it.
What manufacturer wants is the last standard version, state of the art, a bit of anger.
Hey guys!
What's the notified body position on all this?
What's your position?
Position on what?
The last standard version as state of the art.
We don't know now, but we will know.
I need an answer now, or there will be some drama.
Maybe a solution?
What if I put the common specification as the new harmonized standard?
Yes, why not? And a surprise.
You have 4 weeks to draft me a new mandate.
Maybe.
This was the EU Commission telenovela. More drama, please. To be continued.
So I want to tell this is a parody, so don't think that it is true. All what is inside is really fiction. If there is anything that is similar to the reality, it's really by coincidence. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed it. Okay, so now let's go to the next topic, which is the Green Belt certification. So Easy Medical Device initiated the Green Belt certification so that students can learn more about EU MDR and get some practical exercises about it. So it's not just theory, it's really practical things that we are going through. So we have created the mini course, which is kind of really an entry level where people have to get the basic understanding of what is EU MDR. Now we arrive to the Green Belt certificate, which is more an intermediate level, where we are going to basic or to not high level items, but we are really going deep inside them and we are really looking at all the aspects. For example, we have made some quizzes also on LinkedIn of what the students are trying to learn. For example, learning about how to read an UDI number, learning from a product to understand if it's a medical device, what is the classification, what are the conformity assessment routes, etc., etc. So it was really an interesting journey. So I have done that within 1 week with around 17 students. So we had some live sessions, some quizzes, some assignments, what was really appreciated by the students. And at the end, they had to pass the certification exam. And actually, the rate is 60% of success. So I really thank everyone for having participated to that. And yeah, I know that it was a bit difficult certification exam, but yeah, as I've said, it's something that is really showing that you are able to execute some EU MDR requirements. So the new session for the EU MDR Green Belt certification program will start on July 20th until July 27th. So the same thing, we have 5 modules. Each day, 1 module. Then at the end, you will have 3 days to perform the certification exam. You have to have 80% to score or to pass this exam. And you have to do this exam within less than a certain amount of time. So it's not like you have 1 day to do it. It's like 30 minutes or 60 minutes. So we'll define that. So if you want to participate, there will be the registration are opening today, so July 6th, and you have to go to school.easymedicaldevice.com in the section course or in the section shop, and you can find the program. There is limited seats, so last time there was also limited seats, and I know that a lot of people were trying to register again after that, but really, yeah, we have really limited seats because we want to make it like a good environment for learning, for discussion, for chatting all together. And if there is too many students, it can be maybe a bit difficult for me. But I will create some other sessions also in August so that it can help everyone. So don't hesitate to join. And I wish you good luck if you are there, because as I've said, it's not something that you have just to go. You have really to learn a lot. We estimated around 3 hours of work every day for each student through the LinkedIn, through the live sessions, through the assignments, the quiz, the learning. So yeah, you have really to invest a bit of time on this. Okay, so thank you for all those that will be joining this session, and I really welcome them to that. Now, let's go to the notified body situation. So, in terms of MDR, there is no new notified body. So, we have still 14 notified bodies, no new information, and unless this Monday there is an announcement, but no new information. But within the IVDR, there is one new notified body that was appointed, which is TÜV Sud. So, TÜV Sud was appointed already for EU MDR, but yeah, maybe some people didn't know that it was not for EU IVDR. So now they are also taking application for EU IVDR. So there is now 4 notified bodies for EU IVDR. If we can say there is maybe 3 notified bodies, because BSI UK will maybe be exiting due to the Brexit. But yeah, this is something that is also a bit a problem, because this number of notified bodies is not reflecting really the reality in terms of workload for the IVD industry. So there will be more manufacturers that need certification, but really not a lot of notified bodies. So please, again, start your work on IVDR now. Don't wait, because if you wait, you will arrive with all the crowd, if I can say, all the notified bodies that are receiving a lot of application, and you will be really under the pile, or you will be not taken at all. So it's something that can happen, and this can be really damaging your business. So look at that. Related to Brexit, 1st of July was the date normally where Boris Johnson had to decide if he will extend or not the Brexit transition period. I didn't heard anything about it, but maybe we'll hear it soon. I suppose the answer is no, there will be no extension. So if it's true, then the Brexit will really happen by January 1st, 2021. So this is something that people have to understand, and that you have to make a scenario of it if you are in the UK, or if you are selling your products to the UK. But we'll maybe know more in future. Okay, so let's talk now about standard and guidances. So in terms of standard, we have a new standard, or I don't know how to call it, but it's a new guidance that we were waiting since a long time, which is the ISO TR 24971, which is the guidance for the ISO 14971. So the ISO 14971 was published, but when we have started to read the ISO 14971 version 2019, we start to see a lot of times a nota or information saying, look at the ISO TR 24971, which is the guidance. And we are saying, how can we look at it? It's not already published. So the ISO 14971 was published in December. Now the ISO TR 24971 is published now. So you can get it, and you will see more how to implement your ISO 14971 process. But apparently on this version, you need really both documents to really have the full implementation of your process. So don't forget to get this new version and to implement it within your processes. The new other thing is about some updates. So the MDCG is making some updates of their documentation. For example, we have the MIR form that is updated. This is the form that is used for vigilance reporting. This MIR form was updated, but the problem is that there is no information about what was updated exactly. So if you have registered this MIR form within your quality management system, please look at the new version that was issued and update it within your quality management system, because maybe there is some small differences. Same for the MDCG 2019-60, which is the guidance on cybersecurity for medical devices. It was updated, but when you look at the documents, you have no clue what was the update. This is also something that I would ask maybe the MDCG group, please put an history log or history information about what was the update. The date of the update also will be great. I mean, it's kind of good document practices. So please try to do that. I see that on the next update that I reviewed, which is the MDCG 2018-3, which is the guidance on UDI for a system and procedure pack. There was this table saying that the update is about, I think, section 3.2, where they added a new example, which is good. Then I don't have to try to investigate what was the update on old document, because yeah, sometimes documents are many pages, so I cannot spot what was the change, and I don't want to make a full review again of everything. I know that some of my friends said to me, yeah, take the previous version with the new version and go to a website and make a comparison, etc. I mean, I don't want to do that. Please, just put a table, say to me, it was here is the section that was updated, and it would be really easier for us. I mean, the commission or the regulators are asking us to make more structured technical documentation to provide more good information. So please also do that in your site to provide more structured guidances so that we can really have a better understanding of what is inside or what changed from version A to version B. Then there was the new guidance that was issued is about the transitional provision for consultation of authorities on devices incorporating a substance which is considered as a medicinal product or of TSE susceptible animal tissues. So this is MDCG 2020-12. So if you have one of those products that contains a medicinal substance or an animal origin TSE substance, then the notified bodies has to review again your products, even if it was already MDD approved. They have to review that with an MDR. They have to go to the competent authorities that can review that for them. Even if you choose one competent authority, the notified body has also the kind of transparency. It can also go to some other competent authority. It's not obliged to go through your competent authority. So it's something that they can also make. So don't be surprised of it. But if you have this kind of products, so please go to this this guidance, and you will see exactly how those things will be implemented. Okay, this is all for the guidances. So now, what happened within the Easy Medical Device for the month of June? So first, we had the podcast with the episode 80, where we talked about how to execute an internal audit. So internal audit is something that maybe is happening now during this context of coronavirus. There is maybe some remote audit that are done or some on-site audit, but you have to do your internal audit. So I try to explain you how to do that. What is an internal audit? What is the outcome? How to select maybe your auditors, etc., etc. So please, if you are still struggling to understand internal audits for your medical devices, so go to this episode and look at that. Episode 81, we looked at how to make a process validation with Adnan Ashfaq from PharmiMed Limited. So it was really an interesting episode because we have really explained in, I hope, simple words how to perform process validation. And Adnan also offered his validation starter kit where he's providing all the guidance on how to perform a process validation and some templates also of how to do that. So go to the show notes of this episode and you can download the document directly. And lastly, we had episode 82 with a successful EU MDR certification. So we had Choukoufé from Stroman who explained to us how they made it to the EU MDR certification. It was really a great episode because she provided some practical example of what happened, what went wrong, what we can have improved, etc., etc., which is something that maybe people can inspire for their certification audit. And within the LinkedIn Live, we had how to create the best Kappa ever with Karen D. Badwal. So this LinkedIn Live is providing you really some great information about the process for Kappa. So Kappa is corrective action, preventive action. So you can go there and you can check exactly what are the different steps, what are the mistakes also that companies are making, because Kappa is mainly one of the most important issue that we find during an audit. So it's something that can be really a problem for you. So learn how to do it in the good way. And you can also get the presentation on the download, so for that. Okay, So this episode is finished. So thank you for listening to that. Don't forget to provide a review. Don't forget to subscribe also to the YouTube channel if you want to get more videos. And I wish you a nice day.